grew up in Chicopee, Massachusetts, which is in the western part of the state. And I went to high school in Springfield. So for me, my kind of hometowns were Chicopee and Springfield. That's where I had most of my friends. Definitely grew up playing sports. When I was young, my dad encouraged me to play a lot of different sports, actually. So I played soccer, hockey, basketball, baseball. Loved football. Never actually played that on a team. But yeah, I played everything. So I think when I was young, it was just about trying all the different things out. And I don't even know how this started, but my dad actually one winter decided to make a hockey rink for my brother and my sister. So I got into hockey because he made a rink for us. So that was a heck of an experience. And that was another sport aside from soccer, which I coach, that I love as well. For me to get to MIT was a little bit of a coincidence. You know, I was working with a coach as an assistant at Framingham State College, and she took the job at MIT. So I came with her. So in that regard, I think wherever she went, I probably would have gone with her. That's what got me to MIT. And I was an assistant for 3 years and then became the head coach. So as far as my getting into coaching, it definitely was a little different than some coaches you might run into. I wasn't someone who, you know, always wanted to be a coach and knew that. You know, I did play college and high school. Sorry, I played sports in high school and college. And I actually was kind of moving on from college, working, not really thinking that much about coaching per se. And I just started to miss sports. And I think I was playing sports, you know, as you often do out of college, you know, with your friends and men's leagues and co-ed leagues and stuff like that. But I just really started to miss, I think, that high kind of intensity of when you compete with the team. So that's what kind of got me back into wanting to get involved. At that time, I was, my background is as a journalist, and I was working as a news reporter. So when I started to miss sports, I actually looked out for ways to get involved in sports with writing. And at the time, I got the opportunity to work with the Boston Breakers, which was a women's professional soccer team. And I was just helping them do game day stats, website write-ups, that kind of stuff. Just fun way to stay involved in a sport that I enjoyed, and did that for a little bit. And that league at the time actually folded, unfortunately. So it was that following year when I thought, man, I really missed being involved in that kind of high level competition. So at that point, I started looking for ways to get involved with college soccer. I actually didn't have a lot of coaching experience at that time at all, really. At that time, I kind of knew I enjoyed like the high level part of the game, the tactics of it. And so I just started looking for a way to get involved. Not trying to cheat it, but I don't think I wanted to spend 5 years, you know, coaching little kids how to dribble. So I kind of looked to see if I could get involved, you know, just as in someone who'd been working with the pros, you know, watching games, writing stuff up, understanding the bigger picture, and hopefully, you know, using that to contribute in some way to a college team and start to learn the rest of the trade. And that's what got me going, you know, and it said that after that, I ended up latching onto a good coach that was a good mentor to me. And I came with her over to MIT. And I mean, I think I got really lucky to come over to MIT at a time when the program was I think, ready to go to that next level and to get an opportunity to take over as the head coach. You know, sometimes you're just in the right place at the right time. And I definitely feel that way. Certainly worked hard once I got the chance to be the coach here. But I do look back and feel like there's definitely a lot of coincidence, a little bit of luck to get a chance to be the head coach here. So I think I've watched enough of these to know that most coaches talk about the players and the student athletes here, and I agree with that 100%. So I'm going to try to narrow it down even a little more in a way. I think what's so special about MIT and the types of student athletes you get to work with, I think it's their drive and, you know, their ambition to be successful. But I also like that it's not at the expense of, in this case, academics, because I think it just brings a little bit more balance to what you're trying to do. And I mean, frankly, I feel like when we have struggles, because these students go off and have to work so hard in school, and I think it's like they have to put it aside a little bit. And a lot of times when you have a bad game or a bad week or performance, it's good to put it aside. So I think they have a built-in mechanism here to do that. And you know, I think that's a really great thing. And, you know, I think the STEM minds are very organized. So I know for our sport, having a team full of players that are able to digest feedback from coaches and tactics that you want to play very quickly and put it into place. I think my favorite story that I always tell people is just like, you know, most of the coaching I've ever done when something's not working, it's like the players turn to you and they're just like, coach, fix this. And I think at MIT, what I love is the players here will turn to you and kind of have a thought of how to fix it, or they definitely want to be involved in the process of fixing it. And I think as a whole, as a coach, if you're willing to be accept that mindset, I love it. And I think it's great. I think it makes our team better, so that whenever we have a challenge, we're all solving it together. They're not just waiting for me to say, do this, do that. Well, I think in the context of sports, the one thing that's always probably interesting when I meet new coaches or players is just as a coach, you know, I'm also someone who really enjoys reading, right? I love to read. I love writing. Having worked as a journalist, I love music. So I think I definitely have an artistic side that you don't always think about for coaches. I'm sure some have it too, but that always comes up as being a little bit surprising to people. Like, I'm always reading on the bus. You know, I love reading something for me, and it's just like, you can learn stuff, but it also gives you a rest and, you know, a little bit of escape from what's going on in the world. And then the same time with that, what's also really funny, I always find is when people get to know me, is that even though I read constantly, I literally don't own books. So that's a strange thing. People are always like, wow, you must have a big library. But I've always supported libraries. I love libraries. I love going to them, just walking around, finding stuff to read. It's interesting. So until the pandemic, I owned probably about 10 books, even though I love to read. But so now it's funny because with the pandemic and the libraries were most of them closed. So my book collection has probably tripled, but it's still less than 30 books total. So for a reader, that's a little bit unusual. I think, you know, having been here a long time now, 16 seasons, I think you're always reflecting back on each year and the great parts of each year. So I try to have a good memory about all of my teams, I think. But of course the championships and the tournament championships stand out, new MAC tournament championships. It's just exciting. I think at our level, that's the opportunity to win a trophy on the field, and, you don't get that many of them. So I think ultimately when you get that chance, you want to take advantage of it. And I mean, I've lost in the finals, I've won in the finals. So I think, you know, there's great memories with all of them, but certainly when you do win, there's a great memory for them. And, you know, I think all of those to me are special, and I don't know that I would separate them out. I mean, the only thing I would say is I think the first time you do things, that's definitely special. So, you know, the first new MAC championship, 2009, when we beat Springfield, that's just seemed like we beat Springfield and Wheaton in the same weekend. It just seems like at the time, it seemed like something we would never be able to do. So I think that feeling, that first chance to go to the NCAA tournament, I will always remember that one. And I think the first Sweet 16 berth, which for soccer means you're coming back a second weekend. That was special as well, 2012. And it was an overtime goal, which is kind of the most exciting thing we have in soccer in a lot of ways. So those two moments were certainly very special. But I think all my teams, all the championship teams for sure, you're going to remember stuff about all of those. Well, the best recruits at MIT are always the ones with the best SAT scores or ACT scores. That's my joke, but also true in some ways. But I think ultimately, I mean, when you talk soccer specific at this point, you know, you need someone who's a good athlete, but they just want to get on the ball. And like, you know, players that want the ball are going to impact the game no matter what position. You know, you might be the world's greatest defender, but if you just fall apart when you get the ball in terms of trying to pass up the field, it has an impact, you know? So I think when we're recruiting, you know, beside the fit academically and what they want to study and that kind of drive, you're just looking for someone who is a good athlete, you know, driven and really just wants the ball. Like, you got to want the ball in this game. And I think, you know, we have a lot of players like that, and it has a big impact on the success of our program. So, you know, you always get this question from recruits, what's a typical practice look like? And I always say, I'm like, look, we're not trying to reinvent the wheel here. I mean, you know, I certainly spent years studying coaching. I did work in club for a while too, as well. My assistants taught coach club, high school, college. So it's like, you know, we're not reinventing the wheel when we're out there. I think what we're trying to do in particular at MIT, in light of sometimes very challenging days, is get the team going really quick. So we just like, when we start and we get going, and we want to get right into after warming up, like immediately into playing. And I think, you know, that's the big thing is you get into something that's just like a lot of touches on the ball, not thinking a ton about anything beyond the ball's right there. What am I doing with it? And I find once you get in, you know, 15, 20, 25 minutes in with that mindset, then you can kind of come back as a team a little bit more and look at more bigger picture, even tactical stuff. But, you know, for us in particular, just getting players out on the field once they're warmed up and just getting the ball at their feet as much as possible. And look, you know, we want to have fun out there. I know, again, you know, for some people that might have been their toughest day of the week, and you're always going to have a few out there feeling like that. So, you know, trying to get players moving, having fun, playing the game. You know, again, it's like the emphasis for us is just getting the ball as much as possible on your feet and working that way. And, you know, we definitely have some competitions that we do that I think the team really enjoys. So, like, some of them might just be for the day, but we also have a couple that go throughout the season. So that gives us some breaks a little bit in terms of, you know, we have a day where we're most of our practice is focused on our ongoing competition where the players have teams and we're keeping track over the course of the season. I find that stuff very enjoyable as well. I think when it comes to big games, you know, I mean, I having played in a lot of them now, luckily, you know, I think 7 championships, NUMAC championships, you know, I've definitely learned more over that time about what's important. You know, obviously you think the practice before the championship is the most important one of the year. And I think in the beginning, I probably was trying to win a championship that day. But I think what I've grown to learn really is that, you know, you have to be preparing for that championship the entire season from day one all the way through. And in fact, with our team, we talk about, you know, the winter and for soccer, that's the off season. You know, when the new year starts, it's like that's actually when we start preparing to win the NUMAC championship or win a big NCAA tournament game. And it does really hold out to be true, I think, ultimately. I think it's a good mindset to have. You know, when you got one or two practices before a big game, that's not going to be enough to fix, you know, all your problems. So I think you got to be prepared and continue to work towards that all season. And you know, when I think of my 5 NUMAC tournament championships in my time, It's like, I mean, we won one on a penalty kick. We won one on a corner kick and we won one on an own goal, which in soccer means deflects off the other team and goes in. Those are all things we train all the time. And I think, you know, when I look back and see that, it just reinforces to me. It's like, it's about what you're doing the whole time trying to win that championship, you know? And I think, you know, it's clear to me that if we don't practice those things, not just one practice or two practices before a championship or big game, you know, you're not going to be successful with it, but it's just something that you're doing constantly and it's ingrained into your program and your players and the coaches. That's what matters. And, you know, those big games are nerve wracking, right? So it's like, you know, sometimes that halftime adjustment can be tough. There's a lot of emotion for everybody. So I think, you know, if you have a good pattern of play as a team and how you react to situations and you've been through it before, you know, that's the stuff that comes out in those big games. And like, I think sometimes the more you can go into that muscle memory type of stuff, one, things are really nerve wracking. And when it's really nervous in a big game, the better you are. You know, it's hard to think and it's hard to create a solution that day in a championship. So I think the more prepared you are going into it, the better off you're going to be as a team.